up, guys? I'm Skyler.
I'm Casey. We are so excited that you have joined us this morning on our live stream, whether it is through our Facebook page, YouTube, or our CF Life app.
If it's your first time joining us online, go ahead and fill out a Connect card on our CF Life app so we can get to know you a little better, and post a comment below this video and tell us where you're tuning in from.
All right, we have also developed a sermon discussion guide. If you're watching through our app, under the video, there is a notes button. You can just click that and follow along with our guide to the sermon.
Guys, we want to know what you're praying for. You can post your prayer request in the comments of this video, or if you would like it to be more private, you can send them to us through our app, and then our staff will get together and pray over.
All right, guys, it's going to be an amazing service.
Service is about to start. Thank you so much for joining us.
Hey, I'm Sam Tollett, and I'm the pastor here at Criminal Fellowship, and this is our podcast. If you want to pursue more information, I didn't like any, if you want to pursue. Hey, I'm Sam Tollett, and I'm the pastor here at Criminal Fellowship, and this is our podcast. If you'd like to pursue more information about our church, or even watch the live video, all right, here we go.
Oh Lord, it's hard to be humble when you're perfect in every way.
So I'll cherish my oily forehead. Yeah, good talk. Am I in the middle where I need to be? So I'm good. Hey guys, thanks for joining us on our live stream today. We hope that it encouraged you and you enjoyed our time. Nope, not our time.
And if I ever did it once, you know that I probably really did it twice. Yeah, I was just getting money for the hype. No, they didn't tell me that it had a price. The devil, he wanted me to sell my soul, but I'm never giving up on Jesus Christ.
Why are you sad, though? Is it because you're not preaching?
Why do you keep asking me whether I'm
you
sad?
You just look sad.
I think I'm pretty happy.
All right, I'll just see you at Love Cross.
All right, I'll see you there.
To come up here. So we've got him different stuff every service. So first service was a carrot cake. Last service was an Airbnb gift card and a coffee gift card. And this is a basket of all of your favorite snacks and a dad joke book because he loves to tell dad jokes. So all of these things, we just are so appreciative for the way that you lead CF. We're also appreciative of the goofy side and all the fun that we get to have with him. So
thank you. All right. Thank you, Samantha. Thank you, church. Thank you very much. I do want you to know how thankful that I am, Jill is, and our children are for all the love and all the encouragement that you give us as a pastor's family. It means a lot. It encourages us. It gives us the fulfillment to keep doing what God has called us to do and to be who God has called us to be. So thank you for that. Thank you for letting me be myself and having a good time while doing it. And so it's been a big honor for us to be able to serve Criminal Fellowship in this capacity, and can't wait to see what God continues to do. So thank you so much for loving on me and my family.
So he didn't know this picture he took in Alaska, he was not prepared for us to have it up on the screen. He thought he was just being silly, but we use all the things that Sam does. So if y'all are ready, let's stand up and worship this morning.
Come on, let's give God praise this morning, church.
He who would take my cross to Calvary, pay the price for all my guilt, who would care that much about me? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Oh, he makes a way where there ain't no way, rises up from an empty grave, ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is great, and the good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about
God praise this morning, church.
Faithfulness.
together.
You heard your children then. You hear your children now. You are the same God. You are the same. You answered prayers back then, and you will answer now. You are the same God. You are the same. You were providing then. You are providing now. You are the same. You are.
It says this. It says, I am the Lord and I do not change. That is why you descendants of Jacob are not already destroyed. Ever since the days of your ancestors, you have scorned my decrees and failed to obey them. Now return to me and I will return to you, says the Lord of the heaven's armies. I know that God is saying return to him this morning. But more than that, he longs for you to worship him, guys. He longs for your praise, that he sent his only son to die on a cross for us this morning. Amen. He is worthy of our praise this morning. I don't know about you, but I know the struggles and I know the places that I've been. And I'm so thankful this morning to raise my hand and say thank you, God, from a heart of gratitude for bringing me out of that pit that you brought me out of and taking me to a palace. And to know that he is the same God yesterday, today, and forever. That he's still a healer. That he's still a provider. That he still hears our prayers this morning. That he's still moving. We either believe it or we don't. It's that simple. And if we don't believe it, then we can just rip it out. Because he's still a healer. He's still a mover. He's still doing things. He's still working in our hearts. And he's deserving of our praise this morning. Amen. The same God yesterday, today, and forever. It's not my words. It's the scripture. He is the same God. He is the Alpha, the beginning, and the Omega, the end of everything. Of everything. He's the author of your story, of your journey, and he deserves that praise this morning. And you know, even when darkness tried to creep in and write your story and rewrite your story, he came in and was like, nope, it's with my blood, my grace, that they are covered. And he's continually writing our story, even right now. Are you thankful for that this morning? So I want us to sing this next part out, that he freed the captives then and that he's still freeing hearts even right now in this moment. Let's sing it out together.
You freed the captives, then you're freeing hearts right now. You are the same. You are the same. You touch the leper. I feel your touch right now. You are the same God. You are the same God. Oh, you are the same. I'm calling on the Holy Spirit. Almighty River, come and fill me again. Come and fill me again. Come and fill me again.
Come on, just the voices.
Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you.
Come on, would you just raise your hands this morning to worship?
Oh rock, oh rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness, on your faithfulness. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Oh rock of ages, I'm standing. On your faithfulness. You are faithful. Thank you, Jesus. You are faithful, God. You are faithful, God.
God, we just thank you for your faithfulness this morning, Lord. That even though we don't deserve it, God, you still pour out your love, your mercy, and your grace on us. We can't earn it, but you freely give it to us, God. And that even in our sin, even while we were dead in sin, you still gave your life for us. You came for us, and you rescued us, God. Thank you for that kind of love, grace, and mercy this morning, God. And that we should be able to continually show others that kind of kindness, that kind of compassion, that kind of grace, because you first showed us that kind of grace and compassion, God. Help us, Lord, to seek you first, your kingdom, in all that we do, God. To seek you first, to return to you. God, I pray that you would open our heart this morning to receive your word, that we would stand on every promise, that we would stand, that we would leave this place standing firm on your word, knowing that your promises are yes and amen. We'll never fail to give you all the praise and honor for it. In Jesus' name. And we all said,
amen.
Amen. You may be seated.
Morning, church.
Morning.
We all doing good?
Yeah.
All right. You got out of bed. You look good. I mean, come on. That's half the battle right there, right? So we're continuing on with the I Choose series. So a little bit of a warning here. You're probably not going to like the I Choose that I chose for you, okay? So take a deep breath and just look at your neighbor and say, we'll get through this somehow. So we're going to be reading from Galatians 5, start with verse 22. That's the fruit of the Spirit. List those nine fruit of the Spirit in there, and we're going to hone in on one, and here we go. It's self-control. Yeah, gotta love it, right? But you know what I'm convinced of? In one way or another, on one level or another, every one of us deal with this issue of self-control. Sometimes we do well at it. Sometimes we don't do so well. So before we get into the self-control part, I want to unpack the fruit of the Spirit just a little bit. And as we start into this verse in verse 22, it says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, and all the rest of it. So because that word is there, it's just like a therefore. You have to find out what the therefore is there for, meaning it's tied into something that preceded this. And it's no different with the word but. In the Greek grammar, it's actually called a particle, and Greek grammar has a few different particles. This is an adversative particle. It means it stands in contrast to what came before. And what came before was Paul listing those 17 obvious acts of the flesh. And now he begins to juxtapose that, put it next to it, and say, here's the opposite of that. Here's the contrast. So the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And so we see that this fruit of the Spirit stands in direct contrast to verses 19 through 21, where it gave those acts of the flesh. And so those 17 obvious acts of the flesh, they ran the gamut from adultery to fits of rage to drunkenness. Now, those acts in verses 19 through 21, they characterize our lives before Christ. The fruit of the Spirit, sorry, I think I'm going from puberty to menopause or something. I skipped adolescence altogether, so yeah. Adolescence, that tractor left the shed a long time ago. So, the fruit of the Spirit, let's describe that. The fruit of the Spirit is how our lives should look now as Christ's followers, okay? The fruit of the Spirit is that which is produced in our lives when the Holy Spirit takes up residence within us at our salvation. The acts of the flesh were those things that were produced by our sinful nature. And our lives now, our new lives in Christ, should be characterized by fruitfulness. Here's the thing. All living things are to bear fruit. And I challenged you a few weeks ago in a sermon. I said, go through, especially the four Gospels, and check out every place where something that was supposed to bear fruit and did not came to a bad end. We're going to see some of those examples this morning. We're going to go to John's Gospel, chapter 15. Going to pick out some selected verses there. Verse 1 and 2, Jesus said, I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes it so that it will be even more fruitful. Verse 4 and 5, he says, remain in me, as I remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine. You are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. Now you notice it. Jesus didn't say you might bear much fruit, or if you feel like it, you can bear fruit. That's the declarative. You will bear fruit if you're connected to the vine, if you are connected to Christ. And if in your life you find more things coming out of those obvious acts of the flesh and not very many of the fruit of the Spirit, you might want to check that connection. You might want to check that connection to make sure you're a branch that's connected to the vine. Because if you are, you will bear fruit. Verse 6, if you do not remain in me, you are like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burned. There's that bad end I was telling you about. In verse 8, Jesus says, this is to my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. Did you catch that? We show ourselves to be his disciples. We show that we are branches that are connected to the vine if we bear much fruit. Same concept in Matthew 7, verses 15 and 16, although it's kind of on the other end of the spectrum. Jesus said, watch out for false prophets. He said, they come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ferocious wolves. By their fruit, you will recognize them. By how they live, by what their lives produce, you'll be able to recognize them. He goes on to say, do people pick grapes from thorn bushes, or do they get figs from thistles? Likewise, every good tree that bears good fruit, but a bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, and a bad tree cannot bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down, thrown into the fire. Another example of that bad end. In verse 20, he says, thus by their fruit you will recognize them, by what their lives produce. Here's another way to recognize a Christ follower, a branch attached to the vine. A new command I give you, Jesus said, love one another as I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. What was the first of the list of the fruit of the Spirit? Love. I think we nailed it down pretty tight, didn't we? If we have been saved and filled with His Spirit, we will look and act differently from the world. We will look and act differently than we did before Christ. Remember when John the Baptist was down at the River Jordan? He was dunking people. And, you know, John the Baptist was pretty direct about things. He really didn't mince words. And he called the religious leaders that came down to see what all the hoopla was. He said, hey, he said, you're all a bunch of snakes. And he said, what you need to do is you need to bear fruit worthy of repentance. And what he was telling them was, true repentance brings evident proof. And that proof is a fruitful life. Remember the definition of repent? To change one's mind for the better, accompanied by a hatred of one's past sin. See, repent, literally, if I could give you a visual demonstration, it's like we're going this way. We were born in darkness. We were born in sin. And so we're just walking through life in darkness. And at some point, hopefully, we meet Jesus. And what we do is we repent and we turn and we begin to walk the other way, and now we're walking in light. You see, it has to do with we were born bearing bad fruit. And so as we're walking through our life bearing bad fruit, we hopefully come face to face with Jesus. We repent and we turn around, and now our life is characterized by fruitfulness. We were born in sin, so we're walking through this life and all we can do is sin more. And at some point, hopefully, we meet Jesus and we repent and we turn, and now we're no longer sinning more, but we sin less. I didn't say sinless. I said sin less.
That's right.
There it is. I had a friend, Kevin Turner. We traveled a lot together in missions out in Oklahoma, and he wrote something a few years ago, and I thought it bear repeating. He said, the gospel of Christ is inherently a missionary gospel. It is a message that changes a life. It changes a course. It changes affections, changes values. It changes worldview. It changes loves. It changes loyalty. And it should change either our giving or our going or both. But the gospel cannot leave you as you are, the way you are, and where you are, or it cannot possibly be the gospel that you have received. If we have received true saving faith, it will be evident in the way we live. The fruit of the Spirit is the outward demonstration of the inward work and transformation that the Holy Spirit does in our hearts. One obvious and evident characteristic of a Spirit-filled and Spirit-changed life is that ninth fruit of the Spirit, self-control. Hey, just say it a couple times yourself, okay? You know? I mean, kind of get used to the idea. You know what I'm saying? Self-control, okay? makes it a little easier to accept. And let's be honest, like I said, it hits us all on one level or another. It comes from the word temperance, which the Greek word is ekratia. And what that means is the virtue of one who has mastered their passions and desires, especially the sensual appetites. And those sensual appetites would be the gratification of the senses and of the flesh. You see, the world has a mantra that is absolutely diametrically opposed to that. And it goes like this: if it feels good, do it. You know, the general population of humankind, we're not really hardwired for self-control. It's not really in the DNA of humankind. It's not really, self-control is not really our default setting. You know how I know that? Because there's not lines outside of all the gyms in town. But there's a line that wraps halfway around McDonald's on any given day. You get me? Yeah, every time I say McDonald's, I think of my old buddy that I worked with years ago, Jim from Arkansas. And he'd go, "Hey, man," he said, "we're going to McDonald's. You want some?" McDonald's. And I said, "Why do you call it McDonald's instead of McDonald's?" And he looked at me like I'm the stupidest thing on the face of the earth. And he said, "Because they sell Big Macs, not Big Mix." Can't argue with that kind of logic. Of these obvious acts of the flesh, the sensual nature, which is listed in the verses 19 through 21 of the obvious acts of the flesh, are all examples of the opposite of self-control. And drunkenness, in particular, is the polar opposite of self-control. Because if you're not drunk, then you're sober. And that word sober in Scripture, the Greek is napho. And what napho means is calm, temperate, controlled, in control. I always like those ads on TV for alcohol. At the end's that little tag, drink responsibly. Whatever. Any sense of responsibility is about the first thing to go out the window, right along with that long neck beer you whip out the window. I'm gonna sound like I know what I'm talking about, don't I? 1 Peter 5:8, be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. You see, drunkenness is a state of being out of control, and alcohol is not the only way you can get there. You can be drunk or out of control on anger, on lust, on power, and greed. Make no mistake this morning, self-control is a choice. The Holy Spirit gives us the capacity to choose. We as believers can choose at any given moment whether we're going to walk in the Spirit or give in to our old flesh, sin, nature, and desires. It's our choice. Walking in the Spirit. A lot of people got really goofy ideas about what that means. Listen, there's nothing mysterious about it. A lot of people think that if you're walking in the Spirit, you somehow, you know, you come up to somebody and talk to them and you're looking like 5 inches above their head and like you're gazing into the spiritual realm and you say these spiritual esoteric phrases, and that's goofiness. You know, so I see some of you smiling. I know people like that. And if you don't know anybody like that, then you might be, no, never mind. Let me give you an example how this plays out. Walking in the Spirit is as simple as making a choice between whether we're going to obey the dictates of our old nature or whether we're going to obey the fruit of the Spirit. Which one are we going to walk in? It's real simple. So you get up in the morning, you're having your coffee, you're praying, you know, you're doing your devotion, you're studying, and you get done, and you get ready to go for the day, and you're feeling pretty good. It's like, yeah, me and God, we got it going on. You know, we're tight. He's smiling on me right now. And then you get in your car, and You're on West Avenue, and somebody comes just barreling out of a side street and cuts you off, or you got to slam on your brakes, and you almost have a wreck, and then they slow down to about 10 miles an hour right in front of you, and then they turn at the first street. Come on. We've all been there. And here's what it comes down to. What are you going to do at that moment? Are you going to walk in the flesh, or are you going to walk in the spirit? Are you going to be the old man, or are you going to be the new man? Are you going to practice self-control or lack of control? Because here's what we want to do. We want to take the butt of our hand right there, and we just want to mash that horn down. And then we want to yell and scream in a fit of road rage, and maybe even give that person the one-finger salute. Come on. And you know what? When it happens, we want to. We think, oh, that would feel so good for a little while. That's how simple it is about walking in the spirit or walking in the flesh. And listen, people got all kinds of excuses, all kinds of justifications. Well, brother, I couldn't help it. The devil made me do it. Oh, yeah, right. Let's blame it on the devil. Sure. It was the devil's fault. Listen, for a believer, the devil can't make you do anything. He can entice you and he can tempt you, but he can't make you do anything. The devil made me do it. Eve tried that in the garden, remember? It was the serpent. He deceived me. Now, guys, before you go throwing shade on Eve and on the rest of womankind, Adam was even more pathetic. He blamed it on God. He did. It was God's fault. He said, it was that woman that you gave me. Here's what you need to remember. I'm going to give you three little words. This will stick in your brain. And it's going to come up. Might come up tomorrow. Might come up before you get out of the parking lot here. I'm just saying. Three little words. Get a grip. Because it's our choice. Whether we want to get a grip. Wish I could think of something clever to go with that. Get a grip, don't gripe. I don't know, whatever. Just made it up on the fly. The devil doesn't make us do anything. Here's what James says. Each person is tempted when they are dragged away by their own evil desire and enticed. When the evil desire conceives, it gives birth to sin. Nowhere in there does it say each person is tempted when they're dragged away by the devil. Listen, we got to own it, people. We got to own it. It's not the devil. It's our own evil desires in our old flesh nature. Here's another justification Christians use. Well, brother, so what if I lose control once in a while? I'm under grace. All right, let's look at that. There's somebody that has something to say about that. It's the book of Titus. Some of you are going, is that in the Bible? Yeah, it's one of them little bitty books. I'll help you find it. It's right before Philemon. Well, was that not helpful? All right, it's right after 2 Timothy. Or it'll be right up here on the screen momentarily. Titus chapter 2, verses 11 through 13. For the grace of God, grace, charis, is the Greek word. It's the same grace by which we're saved, the unmerited favor of God that we don't deserve and can't earn. By charis, grace, we were saved through faith. Same word, same Greek word. For the grace of God has appeared that offers salvation to all people. It teaches us, and I'll stop there for a moment. Let's identify it. What is it that's teaching us something? Well, it's the subject of the preceding sentence, which was what? The grace of God. So let's plug that in there in verse 12. For the grace of God teaches us to say, get a grip. Now that was me that taught you that. All right. It teaches us to say no. Just say no. To what? Ungodliness and worldly passions. Read the flesh, the sensual appetites. Here's what else the grace of God teaches us. To live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age. While we wait for the blessed hope and the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. You see, the grace of God teaches us that it isn't just some sort of handy rug that we can just sweep our sin and our uncontrolled bad behavior under. Let's go back to Galatians 5, last part of verse 23. See, when we live saying no to ungodliness and worldly passions, when we live self-controlled, upright, and godly, Galatians tells us against such there is no law. You see, as Spirit-filled believers, we don't need someone or something to tell us how we should live. God has put that in us. He has written His laws upon our hearts. The Spirit-filled and directed believer has an inner witness to direct how they should conduct themselves at any given time. So, if you're going down West Avenue and you're going 50, 60 miles an hour, and you get pulled over by one of our city police officers, you got no excuse. Yeah, it's posted. There's signs there that say 30. Some of you are going, it is? It is. But you see, if we are Spirit-filled believers, we don't need a sign posted. Because there's something in our hearts that tells us it's not very smart to drive more than 30 miles an hour down on West Avenue. Because between here and the storehouse, down past Keys Street, there are at least 10 cross streets emptying out into West Avenue. And there are over 40 businesses emptying out onto West Avenue. If you're driving 50, 60 miles an hour down West Avenue, you are in danger of a wreck and maiming or killing somebody. That's why we should obey the speed limit. Not because it's posted, but because God has posted the reason for it in our hearts. See, I got no excuse. My truck, I've got one of those. It actually looks like a little sign, that a speed limit sign. And it tells me on any given road or street that I'm on what the speed limit is. Guess where it's positioned on my dash? Right next to the speedometer. This technology's killing me. Now, you remember the old one with the needle, you know, that went up, the old speedometers, the old school ones? You could kind of fudge it a little bit and say, I didn't realize where that needle was. I got nothing. I got a numeric lighted digital display on how fast I'm going. And right next to it is this little sign that tells me how fast I should be going. God has written His law on our hearts. I got to tell you, when I was first saved, I never heard a single sermon in those first few weeks telling me that I shouldn't drink whiskey, smoke weed, drop acid, snort coke, and sleep around. But you know what? I knew that I shouldn't do those things because I had an inward witness that was written on my heart that told me those things were not pleasing to the Lord. Galatians 5:24 goes on to say, those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and its desires. Things that are crucified die. If we truly belong to Christ, we will be continually putting to death those passions and desires of our old sinful hearts. We don't really like the whole idea of crucifixion because just like the actual crucifixion, it's painful, humiliating, it's hard, it's uncomfortable. But that's what we're to do with those old passions and desires. Verse 25 goes on to say, since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. If the Spirit is the source of our life, and it is, then we should consciously and deliberately let the Spirit direct the course of our lives. I want to look at a passage from 1 Corinthians 9:27. This is one of Paul's sports analogies here. It says in verse 24, he says, "Do you not know that in a race, all the runners run, but only one gets the prize?" He said, run in such a way as to get the prize. Now, obviously, Paul's talking about more than just runners in a race. He's using the analogy of a race to illustrate how we're to conduct our lives as Christ's followers. He said, run in such a way that you get the prize. In other words, act like you're in it to win it. Paul then describes what you have to do to be a competitive runner. He says, everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. Now, that's kind of a poor translation, because the better translation from the Greek is in the same Greek family as self-control that we saw in Galatians as the fruit of the Spirit. So what he's saying, everyone who competes in the games practices self-control. We know that because in any athletic sport, in order to get on top and stay on top, if you want to be competitive in that sport, you've got to train hard. Athletes don't get to eat just anything they want. Well, unless you're a sumo wrestler, I guess you can eat whatever you want then. And unless you were Babe Ruth, you know. I mean, good thing that guy could cloud a ball out of the park, because it said he would eat 30 hot dogs and 5 bags of popcorn before a game. Now, he could hit the ball out of the park, but if you ever saw him, he was a horrible base runner. I guess you learn to hit home runs, so you don't have to worry about being real fast on the bases. But they don't train just whenever they feel like it. They discipline themselves and they practice self-control. Paul says they do it to get a crown that's not going to last. It's temporary. But he said we do it to get a crown that will last forever. They do it for a fleeting, passing reward. Paul is saying we need to practice the same discipline and self-control as an athlete. The difference is our results will have an eternal impact in the lives of others. Paul goes on to say, therefore, I do not run like someone running aimlessly. Man, you ever see them runners? They're down there in the starting blocks, and they've got their lane ahead of them, and that gun goes off, and off they go. And every one of them is going to try to get to that finish line first, and they're going to run all out. And Paul says, I don't run like someone running aimlessly. Can you see that guy? He's in the starter's blocks, and the gun goes off, and he starts running. He goes, oh, spectators, hey. And he jogs over there and talks to them for a while. And then he gets back in the lane. He runs, and he goes, oh, a shiny javelin. And he goes over and watches them throw the javelin for a while. Is he going to win the race? No, he is not. Paul gives us another analogy from sports. He said, I don't fight like a boxer beating the air. He said, no, I strike a blow to my body, and I make it my slave, so that after I have preached to others, I myself will not be disqualified for the prize. See, Paul's picture that he's given us here is as he's fighting against himself. He's fighting against his own body. He says, I'm not just throwing punches at the air, I'm throwing punches at my own body. The phrase strike a blow to my body is the Greek word hupapiazo, and what it means is to disable or to subdue an opponent. And that's what Paul's saying. He's saying, I'm looking at my body, my fleshly desires, I'm looking at them like they're my opponent, and I'm going to subdue those things. In other translations, Paul said, I buffet my body. That's buffet, not buffet, okay? It's why I don't go to Golden Corral. Because I can tell you right now, I have no self-control in Golden Corral. Everything looks good. And besides, there's kind of that psychological thing. You know, you pay all that money out, and you want to make sure you get your money's worth, right? And isn't it ironic that they call it Golden Corral? You know, a place where they pin up things to fatten them up, right? I know, I just ruined it for some of you. Dang it, we were going to Golden Corral after church. Well, go ahead. It'll be a good chance to practice what I've preached. Myself, I'm going to La Costa. I'm going to overeat there. But Paul says, I take my body and I make it my slave. Dulagageo. It's of the same Greek family as doulos or servant. Paul said, I make my body serve me. I'm not going to serve my flesh. And listen, I don't want any misconceptions here this morning. We're not talking about self-improvement to obtain salvation, because you can't improve that much. We can't improve ourselves enough to be saved. That's why it's charis or grace. It's not about gaining points or favor with God. Paul teaches that he practices self-control on behalf of others, to bring others to salvation and maturity, to be an example to those that he's discipling. You know, Paul was dealing with some false teachers who were coming into the church in Corinth, and they were fleecing the people of money, and they were trying to make out like they were somehow super apostles, that they were better than Paul, and the people needed to listen to them. So what Paul did in his letter, his second letter to the Corinthians, he kind of gave his street creds. He said, you know what, here's my resume. I've worked much harder. I've been in prison more frequently. I've been flogged and more severely and been exposed to death again and again. 5 times I received from the Jews the 40 lashes minus one. Do the math on that. 5 times he got 39 lashes. Most people died under the lash. 3 times I was beaten with rods. Once I was pelted with stones. 3 times I was shipwrecked. I spent a night and a day in the open sea. I have been constantly on the move. I have been in danger from rivers, from bandits, from fellow Jews, in danger from Gentiles, in danger in the city, in the country, at sea, and in danger from false believers. He says, I have labored and toiled and have often gone without sleep. I have known hunger and thirst and have often gone without food. I have been cold and naked, and besides everything else, I face the daily pressure of my concern for all the churches. I submit to you this morning that had Paul not practiced self-control in his life, some of those things he might not have survived. Everything Paul did, the things he refrained from doing, the self-control that he practiced, it was all about the churches he was ministering to and the believers that he was discipling. You see, self-control is not about some human energy that we can work up. It's not human-generated strength or ability. It's Holy Spirit ability. It's Holy Spirit-generated strength and ability. And the only way we can do it is if we are attached to the vine. Paul also made it clear he could choose. He could let his physical desires rule his heart and body, or he could let the Holy Spirit rule his heart and body. I had a sister-in-law. It was one of Miss Barb's younger sisters. And when I came into the family, Sandy was still in that whole drug culture, like a lot of us that grew up in the 60s and 70s. She got caught up in that. And a few months after Miss Barbara and I were married, Sandy came to Christ. And I mean, she came to Christ. She was like saved to the bone. We were pastoring the church up in St. Louis at the time, and she was dragging people off the street. She'd go out there on the streets and get people she'd been shooting dope with, and she'd drag them into church. I'll bet she brought 25, 30 people into that church. She loved God. Man, she loved the Lord. But she also struggled with her addiction. And so many times, she went back to those drugs. You see, some really horrible things had happened to her at times when she was shooting dope. Unspeakable things. And the guilt and the shame and the recrimination would just torment her, and she would go back and self-medicate to try to push down those memories. She was in a self-defeating cycle that she couldn't seem to break out of. But I can tell you this, in her darkest times, at no time did she ever deny the Lord. At no time did she ever turn her back on God. We went to see Sandy a few years ago up in St. Louis. She was living in just a horrible neighborhood. And it was incredible. She was, you know, back in her drug stage again. And the collection of people that were in her house was unbelievable. There might be two gay couples and a transgender and a cross-dresser and assorted druggies and alcoholics. And you know why they were there? Because Sandy loved him, and it was obvious. I know that she took clothes out of her closet and gave to girls on the street that didn't have enough clothes. Anytime somebody came to her house, she'd scrape up whatever she had in the pantry and feed them. And they sensed that love. You see, as I look at Sandy's life, and I look at this list of the fruit of the Spirit, Sandy loved people and she loved God. And again, at her darkest times, she would tell you how much she loved God. Joy, it kind of came and went. Peace, at times. But forbearance and kindness and goodness, man, she had tons of it. Faithfulness, I don't know, I guess it depends on how you define that. See, what I've found out in my life is there's been a lot of times that I've been unfaithful to God, but He's always been faithful to me. Gentleness, yeah. Sandy was a gentle soul. But what she did not have was self-control. You see, that's the danger of not having self-control, because it can lead to addiction. And once you become addicted, self-control goes out the window, and now the drugs are in control. And that's a hard cycle to break out of. For people that have never suffered addiction, it's hard to understand the grip and the hold that it gets on people. You see, in Sandy's case, she had a lot of this fruit of the Spirit, but she didn't have self-control, and it killed her. Her body finally gave out on her, and she passed away. And I guess the warning this morning is kind of serious. A lack of self-control can kill you. A lack of self-control can kill a marriage. A lack of self-control in the area of anger and outbursts of wrath can kill the light of joy in a wife's eyes when she finds out that the man she married is full of rage. A lack of self-control can kill a relationship between a mom or a dad and the children. And those outbursts of anger and wrath and uncontrolled rage can take the joy and the innocence that should belong to a child. A lack of self-control is a serious thing. And here's my point. These evidences of the fruit of the Spirit, these nine evidences, it's fruit. It starts as a seed, it grows, it develops, it matures. And all of us in here struggle with some of these that maybe others don't. We're not all on the same level at the same time. Some of the fruit has been developed in some of us at one level and maybe not in another. We're all at different places in that fruit of the Spirit. We will not exhibit at all times and in all circumstances a perfect demonstration of the fruit of the Spirit, including self-control. But thank God that He gave us a Savior that was completely in control at all times. You remember when he was led of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil? And the devil said, hey, he said, took him up on a high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the earth. And he said, all this will be yours, just worship me. That's a pretty big temptation. And it says Jesus was tempted in every point, just as we are, but without sin. And Jesus was fully in control. And he said, no, no, my kingdom's much greater than this. You remember when they came to arrest him that night in the garden? All these soldiers came and they said, where's this Jesus of Nazareth? And Jesus stepped forward and he said, I am. There's a sermon right there. I am he. And it says all those soldiers, for some inexplicable reason, just fell in a heap. And Jesus could have easily escaped. You see, that same account tells us that in that moment, Jesus could have called 12 legions of angels to rescue him from that situation. You know how many 12 legions is? That's over 65,000 angels. But he was in control because he realized he had a mission and a purpose on this earth. Even when he struggled in the garden that night and says he sweated drops of blood, but he stayed in control. He said, Father, not my will, but yours be done. See, the Bible talks about two Adams, the first Adam and the last Adam. The first Adam, he took his own will, what he wanted to do, and ate of that fruit. But the last Adam, again in a garden, gave up his own will to do the Father's will. He was in control because he knew that there was a world, a dying, broken, lost world that needed a Savior. Luke's gospel tells us that Jesus set his face to go to Jerusalem, and he knew what was going to happen in Jerusalem. He knew about the beating, the scourging, the humiliation, and the painful death on the cross, and he set his face to go there anyway. Isaiah, in prophesying of the coming Messiah, said, my servant shall set his face like flint. And when it comes to self-control, that's what you and I have to do. We have to set our face like flint. We have to be immovable. So the question this morning is, what will you choose? I can tell you what God chose. If you're a believer in here this morning, it says he chose you from the foundation of the world. He chose you to be accepted in the beloved. That means to be loved and accepted by his Son, Jesus Christ. Will you choose the one who set his face like flint to go to Jerusalem for you? Will you choose the one who, while you were yet a sinner, he had already died for you? So this morning, we need to make up our mind. I choose the fruit of the Spirit. I choose self-control. I choose to let the Spirit lead and direct my life. If you're here this morning and you have not yet become a follower of Christ, we can help with that. This altar is always open for prayer. These folks here would be honored to pray with you. If you need help in that area of self-control, again, this altar is open, but I want to tell you something. It's not a one and done. Again, it's fruit of the Spirit. It's grown. It matures. It's a process. The process will be worked out in your everyday lives. It will be worked out on West Avenue when somebody pulls out in front of you. It'll be It'll be worked out in your life when somebody presses your button wrong. We all got that button. When we choose self-control or flesh control. When we choose the flesh or the spirit, that's how it'll be worked out. Stand with me this morning as we worship the Lord together.
Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Oh rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness. Come on, every voice this morning. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Oh rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness. On your faithfulness. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now.
How I need you now.
Oh rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness. On your faithfulness. Same God, you are the same God, 'cause you answered prayers. Come on, that's it. And you will answer now. You are the same God, you are the same God. You were providing then, you are providing now. You are the same. Come on, every voice this morning. Hey. You were a healer then. You are a healer now. You are the same God.
You are the same God.
And you were a Savior then. You are a Savior now. You are the same God. You are the same. How I need you now. Oh rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness. On your faithfulness. Come on, one more time. Oh God. On your faithfulness. Guys, I just want to encourage you this morning that, you know, kind of what Pastor George was talking about with this girl that was on drugs. And, you know, sometimes God performs miracles.
Hey, guys, thank you
lives,
so much.
Right? We've seen it. We know that it's possible. But sometimes the miracle may not look the way that we think it should look. Sometimes the miracle is a process.
So, you know, the thing for me is when I was sitting in jail and I remember praying a very raw prayer of, God, where are you? It's kind of my moment of, God, I don't feel you. It doesn't seem like you're even here. If I can go through this and I have to go through all of this mess, then are you even real? Where are you? And I remember in that moment, I kept hearing these words ring in my head. It wasn't like an audible voice or anything like that, but it kept ringing in my head, and I wrote it down. And I kept hearing, when you feel me the least, I'm moving the most. When you feel me the least, I'm moving the most. And I can't tell you how many times I've went back to that message to know that it's not about emotion. It's not about when you feel God, because sometimes when you don't feel he's there is when he's going before you, making every crooked path straight in your life. Amen. And that's what he was doing. And that was my moment. I remember praying, God, where are you? And, you know, it wasn't instant. He didn't deliver and set me free just right then, boom, done, happening. But it was a process. But I knew that he began a work that day. And the Bible says that when he begins a work in you, he is faithful to complete it until the day of Christ Jesus. And that was the moment that he began a work in me, and he's been working in me ever since. And that's how he works with you. So I wanted to encourage you this morning, no matter what has happened in your life, no matter what has transpired, pick yourself back up, dust off your shoulders like this, and do it again, because the Bible says he forgives as far as the east is from the west. And there's nothing too great for our God. There's nothing too big for my Jesus. Amen? He's a good God this morning, guys. And we've got pastors here and leaders that will pray with you. So no matter what's going on, make sure you reach out and pray. They're back here at the hub or up front, whatever you need. We're here for you guys. But let's pray together. Lord, we just thank you, God, that you are the same yesterday, today, and forever. And God, no matter what's going on in our lives, God, no matter how bad it may seem, no matter how much chaos is around us, we know that you are the peace in the middle of the storm, God. And we pray that you hold us in that peace. And God, no matter what we've gone through, we can pick ourselves back up and know that your grace is sufficient for us, God. That your grace covers us, Lord. Not that we would use it cheaply, but we're thankful for that grace this morning, that it covers our sin, God. So help us to walk in holiness as you are holy, God, because you live within us, God, because greater is he that's in us. You are holy, Father. We magnify your name this morning. God, I pray as we go this week that you will speak to us, Lord, that we would be sensitive to go where you tell us to go, that we would say what we need to say, God, no matter what that is. If somebody gets a flat tire this week, God, and you tell us to pull over and help that person, God, convict our hearts to the point that we pull over and we help those people. If it's somebody in front of us in the grocery line and you tell us to pay for the groceries, God, let us be obedient to whatever you tell us to do, Lord. And we will give you the praise for it in advance. And we thank you for what you're doing in our lives, God. And I pray that you continue to move in Jesus' precious name. And we all said, amen. God bless you, church. See you next week.
Hey guys, thank you so much for joining us today on our live stream. I hope that you enjoyed the message and the worship experience. Our prayer is that it was an incredible encouragement to you. If you want to rewatch the message or watch any older messages, you can easily do that. All you got to do is download our CF Life app. When you're on the app, go to CF Crossfield Media. There is where you'll find an incredible library of all of our past sermons. We also want to encourage you to download this sermon discussion guide. It's a tool that we put out every week with the message so that you can use it to dig deeper into the message. Also, if you're someone who's feeling that the Lord is drawing you to surrender your life to Jesus Christ and accept him as your Lord and Savior, we want to know who you are, and we want to get in contact with you and encourage you and to share with you what the next steps of your faith is. And for some of you, you're feeling the Lord leading you into the decision of baptism, because that's the next step of your faith. How do you let us know about salvation, or how do you let us know about baptism? All you have to do is fill out the Connect card by scanning the QR code here. And when you scan the QR code, code. It gives you a connect card to fill out. Fill that information out, submit it. One of our staffs will get it. And when we get it, we'll be incredibly excited to get back in contact with you to share about the incredible news and the decisions that you've made. Also, you can use that connect card to share any prayer requests that you have. If something's laying heavy on your heart and you want some extra prayer for that, then we would love to pray with you and to pray over you and pray for you. So fill out that connect card and submit it, and we'll be praying for you guys. Again, thank you so much for joining CF on our live stream, and we cannot wait to see you next week.